The major institutions in our communities say if you have a felony conviction, if you've been to prison, if you've been to jail, we don't want you. We don't want to hire you. We don't want to educate you. We don't want to sit next to you at church. Many people with felony convictions want to be a part of their children's lives. They want to take them on a field trip to the zoo. Do you think they're allowed to? No, they won't pass a background check. Doesn't matter what they did. It doesn't matter if they wrote a hot check. Doesn't matter if it was a conspiracy charge. Doesn't matter if they committed murder. Everyone's treated the same. Some of you might say, well, hey, they did the crime. There's consequences with that. So let's talk about who goes to prison in our country. Criminal behavior is not the greatest predictor of incarceration in the United States. Race and income are the greatest predictors of incarceration. So let's talk about the facts of that. Let's take race as an example. Individuals who are Black or African American are more likely to come into contact with law enforcement because of racially biased law enforcement practices over policing certain communities. Once they come into contact with law enforcement, they're more likely to get arrested. Once they get arrested, they're more likely to be charged. Once they get charged, they're more likely to be sentenced. Once they get sentenced, they're more likely to be sentenced more severely. And once they get released, they're more likely to come into contact with law enforcement. So we have an institution, a social institution in this country that fails 77% of the time, and the people it's failing are uniquely disadvantaged, sometimes forever. Many people would say always forever. That a felony is a life sentence. This is not acceptable. This is something that more and more people are realizing, politicians, community members, people with access to influence, people that are experiencing it, that we can't do this any longer. We are at a place in our country where we have the moral will, the fiscal will, the political will to transform how we approach criminal justice. We have to acknowledge what the current state of things is. We have to acknowledge that when individuals come home, they often don't do well because our institutions have blocked them. So we have to intervene on the institutions that these individuals return to. But because we've caged human beings and stripped them of all of their dignity, removed them from their family, from their resources, from opportunity to develop their own skill sets, to develop their own psychological well-being, we have to prepare these individuals too so that when we do create opportunities in our communities, they can have access to them and do well and thrive. And help them get prepared for who they can dream to be, not who they think they're going to be allowed to be. What kind of successes might actually happen? We can help them to understand the impact of not having opportunity on our children, on their children, on our communities, because we know that incarceration doesn't work. We know that incarceration makes most people worse. We know that incarceration tears apart families. When parents do well, which are most of our individuals getting out of prisons, their children do well. And when their children do well, they're not committing crimes, they're not getting into trouble, their families do well. And when families do well in our communities, then our communities do well. Transforming our criminal justice system is not an issue that is going away. And it is an issue that we have a moral obligation to pay attention to. Transforming our criminal justice system is the civil rights issue of our time. It's the human rights issue of our time. It's the justice issue of our time. And it's the liberty issue of our time.